Hello. Oops, very loud, but maybe that's good. It's a wake-up call altogether, and not only for us here. I think it's for the society we're living in, the times we're living in. Many of us have been awake, I'm aware. Some of us still try to figure out what is they're seeing when they're opening their eyes with the news, with the heat, with all the trouble we're in right now, actually. But we're not here to celebrate the trouble. I'm not the one to say it's time for pessimism. I'm the one who says we don't have time for pessimism. We need to be patient, though, because what we're doing now, what we're starting today, is a journey towards transition, transitioning of inner journeys, like inner travel, inner work also that needs to be done. But inner development is not an individual matter. It's a question that needs also to be supported by structures from society and alike. And to talk about this for today, we invited Daniel Goertz. Daniel Goertz, may I welcome you to the stage already, on stage already. And Daniel, who is a PhD in sociology, has a PhD in sociology and is a social theorist, written two books, which are available also outside. It's the first one, The Listening Society, under the pseudonym Hansi Freinacht. You might introduce us to this character as well, together with Emil Einar Fries.
Yes, yes, so it's a shared pen name.
Beautiful book, very demanding and also very inspiring to read. So maybe you take a chance and take it with you. The second book, The Nordic Ideology, goes even a bit deeper. It's about politics and psychology. And you will give us now a keynote that I believe, under the general theme of this festival, transition, will give and allow us many, many perspectives where we see it's not about pessimism, it's about patience, because there will be a lot of work to be done, which cannot be done alone, which cannot be done quick, but which has been described by great thinkers as you are.
And thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank all of you. First of all, I want to qualify what she said. I'm not going to promise to deliver on patience, right? I can get a little bit impatient, actually. And this vision, the Listening Society, is a vision of the welfare system of the future. So we have something like in the 1600s, you built up stuff like poverty aid and stuff like that around Europe, and the 20th century, of course, you had different welfare regimes, and the Listening Society would be a vision for future welfare, welfare that goes one step further, that climbs the Maslow hierarchy of needs. And if we honestly look at our own lives and we look at the people around us, it doesn't actually make that much sense for us to be expecting so much more intelligent activism from ourselves, from everybody else, because we're just not there as human beings. We're a little bit too broken, we're a little bit too wounded, we're in the middle of a long-drawn family drama, been there, done that. We're doubtful of ourselves. We might have self doubts, etc. So there's something a little bit sad about now. This whole crisis on a world level is happening. Most of us don't feel it in everyday life, but we know it's out there. We know it might affect future generations very, very, very much. We're beginning to see it, and it's like, okay, we have to act. And then, you know, then you have little children like, or young people like Greta Thunberg. And Greta Thunberg, she started this Fridays for Future, and she got to speak to all of these important people, right? And she says, from a kid's perspective, like, can't you do this? Can't you fix this? You're the adults. And she goes to the heads of states and, you know, the parliament there, and she goes on from there. She goes to the UN. She speaks to all the Hollywood stars and so forth. Eventually, she even gets to the Pope, the person who presumably would have a closest line to God. And she said, and the Pope says, it's good that you're doing this. So we have to ask ourselves, like, who's home, right? Who are we asking to do this, right? There's nobody home. It's just this big empty chaos engine going off the rails. And why is nobody home? Because we're not there. We're not the people. And we couldn't realistically be the people, the kind of person who would be able to respond to super hyper complex, multidimensional things like that. And some of the best people who do those things, they get under so much pressure that they sometimes buckle over. So somehow we're just not made of the right stuff to manage the world that we have created. We created this wonderful and terrible machine, global capitalism, etc. And it fulfills needs, and it flies people all over, and it creates festivals, and it does all of these things, right? And it connects people digitally. I would never have known you, Irina, if it wasn't for Amazon, I guess, because I could publish my books on Amazon. But at the same time, of course, the whole thing is not very sustainable, and it's gonna crash, and people aren't really happy. So it's a little bit terrible, and life could be really, 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 really different. And if you've ever had spiritual experiences, or just experiences of profound healing, or just really beautiful moments in your lives, you sort of know there's a place deep inside you that sort of knows we can do much, much, much better. It didn't have to be like this. And if we did have a more listening society, if people did feel cared and heard about and loved themselves from early on, chances are our capacity to do things together, to affect all of those complex structures, to change all of those contexts, to get out of our conceptual frameworks, to be inventive in idealistic manners would be magnitudes greater. We wouldn't be as stuck, right? So let's stop on this idea then. Okay, listening society, future welfare that sort of helps give us the psychological bearings to manage this time we're in. And to transform, right? Transformation, like Maya was talking about. I don't understand German perfectly, but I understand some of what she said. She said something about we sort of can choose a direction of this transformation. We can do the transformation. We can enact it, right? But for that to happen, we need the contexts that help us change ourselves so that we can change our contexts. And whenever those contexts aren't there, we sort of lock each other in, right? We lock each other in bad communication and whatnot. So let's see, listening society. Everybody knows, like if we do a hand raise, who here knows about, has heard about the Sustainable Development Goals? Most people, right? So it's a huge thing, right? It's and most countries and administrations and so forth are subject to the Sustainable Development Goals and have, well, support them more or less, right? They subscribe to them, and everybody is talking in all of these important conferences about how to fulfill these 17 different goals. And some people are critical, oh, they're too technical, they don't look enough at qualitative data and whatnot, but I'm actually really hopeful about them. It's some of the best stuff we've seen as a global community for where we want to go. It's fairly concrete. Yes, we want education for women around the world, we want clean water, we want climate change mitigation and so forth, right? Now, how many people have heard of this, and be honest, have heard about this concept, the inner development goals? Irina had heard of it, and Florian. So inner development goals is a new thing, fairly new, and instead of 20, or instead of 17, you have something like 23 inner development goals. And there are different qualities that we can have as people. Such things as having a strong moral compass, having being driven by compassion, being able to withstand peer pressure, having integrity, those sorts of things. And if you just look that, down that list of 23 different characteristics that they a bunch of researchers try to gauge, okay, roughly this is what it means for society to develop its population's character, its population psychology, right? Then it becomes very clear that we're not going to make the 17 development goals without first investing a lot, and a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of research, a lot of practice into the inner development goals. It's just not going to happen, because who is going to do it? Well, people who are stuck in all of that peer pressure and all of that, and all of those prestige games, with perhaps a structure of desire that is not sustainable, and perhaps doesn't even fully, honestly desire all of those idealistic things like helping people or animals on the other side of the planet. Do we really care about other species? It takes a certain sort of abstraction, right? Now, the good news, I suppose, is from a lot of behavioral research, contemplative neurology and so forth, you can see that people can actually increase in these qualities. People can become more compassionate, but it takes practice. And practice means time, it means knowledge, it means resources, it means priorities. So, the idea would be that a listening society is a society at a state level, but it can also be a progressive city like Graz or a city-state or a local community, invests into the inner development goals. It doesn't have to be exactly according to their theory, right? You can have many other theories about what it means to develop. I present one or me and my colleague present one in the Hansi Freinach's books. But that's basically the idea. The listening society is a welfare society that has thought out everything, right? Education, perhaps the most important one, but not just education, a society that listens to us. Who here in this room has, during the last year, been in trouble or somehow frustrated by a bureaucracy of our country that doesn't fit? Exactly, your hand just goes up like this. You can't help yourself, right? Because it's really annoying to have bureaucracies that just don't fit, right? There are, for people such as myself, who are sort of outside of the normal labor market, the Swedish system is not all that, right? Basically, they have me running through papers and web pages and stuff. And yeah, and it's more bureaucracy slavery than actual liberating welfare. So it doesn't always live up to its high reputation, the Scandinavian models, right? Because it's built on industrial society, right? And there are so many people in the creative classes and so forth who just don't fit in. Well, that's not a listening society. So okay, public services. What else do we have? We have so many other things we could change. The architecture, right? We're going to have Indy here, an architect. You talk about the culture scene, exactly. But yes, the culture scene can also embody a more listening society, right? Can be more sensitive to us, and sensitive particularly to our relationships, right? So among those inner development goals, more than half of them, or pretty much all of them, are somehow about how we relate to one another. And that's, well, obviously the whole field of how we relate to one another affects how we're going to show up in the world together. And that affects our collective intelligence. We can be individually intelligent and super brilliant, but we don't communicate that well to one another, so we speak past one another, then we can't act on it. So we're going to be collectively dumb. And that's what we are. That's why we're in wars, et cetera, et cetera. And that's why we can't handle climate change. We're collectively dumb, right? So we need to get out of that. And that's to oil that collective intelligence, that would be the listening society. Right. So if I ask here, if I ask here, if there is such a thing as collective intelligence, and if there is such a thing as you can develop the inner development goals, would you believe, each of you, you don't have to answer aloud, but would you believe that some societies are going to be more listening societies than others? More developmentally apt or less developmentally blind? More apt to existential maturity and less apt to existential poverty? This is a controversial topic, right? Because then you're beginning to compare structures of societies. And you're going to say, well, actually, I like that society better. We should be a little bit more like them. And you have to be very careful there not to mix up apples and pears. So it's fairly well known that the Scandinavian societies they're pretty much top of the class in all of those nice measures the UN has about human development. There's high trust in society, high trust in politics. There's high trust among members of society. There's high trust in the authorities. People are happier there. They're more equal than other societies. So I would argue those things are things that are worth learning from and emulating and developing further. And there's a whole history behind how the Scandinavian societies became those beacons of that sort of development. At the same time, of course, Swedish people are reserved, for instance, and a little bit private. Italians, not so much. It's important. Is it maybe that cultural difference that makes Sweden a little bit farther developed, or you can make it even more controversial. Would you like to compare Sweden, a very white Nordic country, with Somalia, and you have less happiness in Somalia, and more poverty, and greater inequality? Gets really, really controversial. Just saying, you have to tease out what is development and what is just different cultures. What is the rich, colorful tapestry of the world that you want to preserve, and what is the developmental direction you want to go in? Either that, or you have to deny that you can develop collective intelligence. Everybody always sort of nods the first part, right? I'm looking at all of you, right? And you looked happy when I said all of those first things, and now you don't look happy. And the obvious reply that everybody has when you say, okay, let's develop societies, you arrogant schmuck, who do you think you are? You want to develop me? You think you're more developed? You think you're from a more developed country? You think you know the future direction? Whew. Well, if it was easy to figure these things out, we already have done it. But that's the main block, right? We have to touch. She also talked about yesterday, we have to talk very honestly with one another, right? We have to touch upon, and I mean, it gets worse than that. That's just comparing cultures. What happens if you start comparing people within a population? If you say, okay, so we should develop compassion. Well, it just so happens, this part of the population is more compassionate than that part of the population. Whew, not so fun for the part of the population who were... gauged or deemed less compassionate, right? Yeah, so that's mental wealth, as Indy will talk about, and it's or you can call it deep capital or cultural capital, other things, right? But if we don't wrestle that issue, if we don't wrestle the issue that, okay, if you've said development, you've also said more or less developed to a certain extent. You also said there's a certain direction. So there are people who are for the segregation of races and for slavery, for instance, and there are people who are against it. Who would you say has the most developed perspective of human nature? So usually it's going to be the people who are against, 99.9% of the cases, right? There are people who don't care about the environment and who say that's a hoax, like, or that we should care about it, it's a hoax. There are people who care passionately about it. Well, you can care passionately about a good thing for a bad reason, and maybe you have misunderstood it, but by and large, we can say that there is more of a developed perspective to be able to take in the biosphere's perspective, right? So development, to answer Irina's question, is when you embrace more and when you coordinate different things, right? Life gets, we're not traveling towards a utopia where there is one point where everything converges, everything becomes one, and becomes simpler and simpler, and one more and more just pointy, just like one omega point. No, that's not what's happening. We're going farther and farther into a more and more complicated, more and more wild, more and more tremendous ride. Of course, like, look at the universe. Of course it's going to be a worse and worse and more wonderful roller coaster ride, a cosmic ride. We're just in the beginning of the universe. Of course it's going to become crazier and crazier. Of course it's going to ask really difficult questions of us. So the Listening Society is the vision that we can have a sense of directionality there, and we can prepare people for this ride, or we can prepare ourselves and one another. And that it's actually, I believe, a less judgmental perspective, even though it sees a certain directionality of more or less developed, because it says, hey, we're okay. It's okay that we're not, we don't have the capacities together to handle all of the difficult things. Why would we have? Do we know how to fix a world market that is based on perpetual growth on a planet that doesn't know how to grow, or that doesn't support that amount of economic growth? We don't exactly, right? We can have a certain sense of the direction. And we don't know how to first diverge into so many so wildly different and beautiful cultures and then converge into a global society while still keeping our cultural differences and respecting one another. We don't know how to handle the paradox of there being development and direction of development, but at the same time that highlights inequalities, developmental deep inequalities between us. So it's a new form of spiritual inequality that we're looking at. It's okay that we don't know how to handle these things, but we can work on ourselves developmentally. Yeah. And I know I'm going off script here. I mean, we had a rough script. So as an example, in education, the listening. So we sometimes talk about transforming. And we sort of make it sound as though one dramatic thing happens to us, and sort of like we saw Jesus or some equivalent, and our hearts flow over, and I'm changed. I was blind, now I can see, right? And there is a wave of that needs to happen around the world, and Eckhart Tolle. He leads that way. If we emulate Eckhart Tolle and so forth, and we all enter into the power of now, and we have no egos, then we will live in harmony with nature, because that's the truth, and then we follow the natural world. I don't believe that. Rather, that would be sort of like the communist version, in a sense, not communist as in this Graz here, but like uncompromising, crazy revolutionary version. Is there a simpler Swedish social democratic version of the same tremendous journey? Or that's why we call it the Nordic ideology, the second book, by the way. And yes, there is, and with something like this. What happens if, with the best research methods and building on collective experience, what if we actually teach everybody to meditate early on and increase their compassion? So maybe it doesn't work for half of the people. Maybe half the people just sit there and are bored. But it would mean that if kids meditate there those 12 years in school, those are 2,700 days. The average person that the other person will meet will be a little bit less concerned with themselves, because you become less concerned with yourself if you get into those states of mind. And you become a little more compassionate, maybe. So you will have over thousands of interactions being in another field of somewhat greater kindness and trust. And you will also have taught yourself to perhaps put yourself in such states, right? And does this cost money? Like, because here's the thing, because we don't have the Listening Society anywhere in the world. Costa Rica, by the way, did sign up for the inner development goals. So there is one country now that's at least official, where the president says, we're going to do this. But that's the only place in the world, and they just said it, right? We'll see what happens, right? But what happens if you would actually do that? It sounds to most people, well, you would be wasting a lot of time. Why would people be sitting quietly, right? But maybe we're changing the nature of desire, the nature of social roles, the nature of interaction over many years, and just see what happens. I'm guessing we would be in a dramatically different form of society. If you could walk down the street and you know everybody had that sort of training for 12 years, and perhaps training in emotional intelligence, and perhaps a little bit coaching and therapy for good measure, and physical education that was more compassionate and more tailored to the individual person's health, and perhaps, who knows, some other things that support your general mental health, better food, for instance, more circular gathering places in education and so forth. You walk down the street and you know all of the other people who you meet have had that sort of upbringing. Are you more or less afraid of the other person? Would you think that they become more likely to hit you and rob you or not? Would you be more or less prone to come over and help the other person? Most likely you'd have higher trust, because you'd have better reason to, because you would see that the whole setting they were in set them up for, just for more pro-social behavior. So think about how much would that save? You didn't actually cost anything to sit down and be quiet for a while, a little bit, but less than other education. How much can we save on police, on violence, on health, on stress? How much can we stop wasting on status games? Do you think the hierarchies in society would be flatter or sharper in that sort of setting? They'd probably be flatter. Like, maybe people are devious, so we sometimes make up like, oh, actually, I'm the best meditator of everybody. I'm the most humble, humblest of all, listen to me. I'm so way above you. Sure, we can make those little loops, but by and large, we'd live in a more egalitarian society, and not faux egalitarian, because we would actually, all connect to universal things, right? So, that's sort of the vision of the Listening Society, and I guess that we're not going to have a deep transformation if we don't do it that way, right? If we expect the great wave, right? Or if we expect the great awakening, we're not going to get there. But if we build step by step for the context and build on whatever behavioral science knowledge and social science we can find, and improve along the way and change best practice, exchange best practices with each other, we can probably actually transform society at depth. Might take a few generations. But, and we don't have a few generations for climate change, but we still have to start that journey, because the farther we're along that path, the easier it still becomes to do all the cool projects that can actually transform emissions and so forth.
So the mission you're talking about, a mission is something never being accomplished on its own. So there's a team, there's not only critical or perspective thinking that is needs to be involved, there needs also to be collaboration, there needs to be creativity. Mm-hmm. And one thing you just mentioned briefly, there was this directionality, not to shy away from saying that this development, this mm-hmm. inner development, and also the societal progress you're thinking of has a direction, which I don't know how much you are into this thinking of the postmodernist, everything is possible, and talking about a direction is almost, I don't know, taboo. Mm-hmm. So you are saying that there are people who already developed those kind of skills better than others. Creative class would be one of those things or groups.
Yeah, something
and also
like that.
Maybe if I continue my little question and then you go again a bit more into detail. On your books, it also says metamodernism in contrast to postmodernism. And I think these are those ways of describing it. Like there's a directionality. You talk about people, maybe some of them here, who have some of those skills already in place.
Yeah, thank you. So what do you call a movement that tries to create a listening society? So, one of the major thresholds that keep us from developing visions like that is that we're all brought up in these last 20 or 30 years to be critical, right? You go to the university and you get a humanities major, or you get a major in the social science. You will all the time learn, okay, what's the critique? What's the counterpoint? How am I critical, right? And did a whole PhD in sociology, so in the sociology department, my colleagues would explicitly say what we give to society is critique, right? And this has become a very deeply ingrained habit. It's not just in the universities, right? So you will have critical investigative journalists, and you will have artists who sort of, all the way back to the early 20th century, you had folks like Picasso, and he sort of smashes the dimensions of Renaissance perspective and so forth, right? So what you have had since that is like a sort of rebelliousness against modern society, that if you want to be intellectual, if you want to be in the know, if you want to be an artist, if you want to be an academic, if you want to be one of the heroes, you're a rebel. You're against something. And all the bankers and engineers, are the square people. They're not against something. They want to create houses and blocks and make everything the same. And they read Descartes 24/7. Now, there's something about that. Okay, if you're always against something, you can never actually say what you're for, and you can't actually gather people, the will of others, around one and the same overlapping vision, right? So that's a bit of a problem. So we really need to get out of the climate crisis, and we really need hope and a sense of direction and somewhere to go and something to build. But whenever you say, I want to do this, people smirk. Oh, that's naive. I used to think like that too when I was a kid. And have you read but Foucault, but power structures, but ethnicity, but language, but hidden capitalist interests that are underneath, right? And it's sort of like we're enthralled by a sort of priesthood of intellectuals. There was this famous French intellectual from the 60s, 70s, early 80s, Michel Foucault. I think many would have heard of him. And he's sort of the patron saint of this sort of thinking. He even explicitly said, when people said, well, wait a minute, you're just against everything. You just rip everything apart for the sake of ripping everything apart. You're not even for anarchism like Chomsky. And he says, you know what? There are so many engineers and economists and bankers in the world. They build it. I just rip it apart. And that spirit sort of went all the way into popular culture in the 90s and later on. So The Simpsons was very postmodern, right? I think a lot of people here must have grown up watching The Simpsons sometimes. And yeah, you know, and basically the show sort of just smirks and pisses on everything. And then came South Park. And South Park was really, really, you know, harsh. It was just against everything. Just nihilistic, a sort of darkness. And a humor, right? And art scholars started noticing about 10 years ago that that a whole generation has choked on all of that sarcasm, on all of that irony, on all of that nihilism. Like, okay, that's fine when you're 18. And the whole rebel thing, well, like the Greta thing, it sort of assumes that there's somebody else in charge, right? Like there's some adult that you can actually rebel against. But once you've grown up and you tried your wings in adult life, and you've seen workplaces from the inside and whatnot, you notice there's nobody home. There aren't any adults here. I never met one. People don't have any, they have no clue what they're doing. And I certainly don't either. But hey, they're just like me. I can't actually rebel against somebody who isn't there. I can't rebel against the fact that somebody didn't develop the skills that they would need to be the person I would like them to be. If I want them to be another person, I have to help create the contexts, the generative conditions that would be conducive for them to, by their own free will, become the sort of person I believe would be good. And I don't have the right to force them to be that person. They have to find that by themselves. And probably they're going to surprise me and become some other sort of person which was better than I would have thought of. But then I can at least start talking about, okay, what are the contexts that we want? And that's the shift from this dark place of irony where sort of the postmodern movement left us off, and where actually the majority of academia and art and culture still resides, you have this sort of swinging back to hope, a new sincerity that people are starving for. So there's this new sincerity that is called the metamodernism. So wait a minute. So you're just talking about progress, the same thing that the early 20th century communists were saying, the whole Whig history thing that we've progressed over the centuries, and the Western people became really civilized, and they took over the world, and science is going to solve everything. No, not that sort of progress. We still keep the postmodern critique. You're never done with it. We're never done with critiquing society. There are always power structures, even here in this room, even, you know, gender inequalities and mansplaining and manspreading and whitewashing and greenwashing and all of the rest of those things. We need to be really, really, really good at demasking those things. But if you're really good at demasking those things, then what do you do? Are you done there? You were the rebel, so now you got to say that the others are bad and that they're sort of part of a racist power structure. What happens then? What do you do with your art? Or what do we do once we have critiqued something together? Well, we should come up with suggestions about how things could be better. And it's usually not by tearing something down. Sometimes, yeah. But usually it's by leading by example and creating new opportunities for new things to emerge, right? And that's an oscillation then, as they say. You know, an oscillation is this wave movement in physics, like particles oscillate, wom, 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 wom. Or they, you can say also from physics that something is in superposition, it's in two places at the same time, but it's equally real at both places. So that's an oscillation between irony, postmodern irony, and hope or progress and sincerity of believing in something. So it's like, it's a little bit like an enlightened madness. I know what I'm saying is complete bullshit and that people are gonna tear it apart. I know it. But you can't do any better. So my bullshit is better than your critique. That's the metamodern position, right? And if you look at places like Elevate, there are some trapdoors you can fall in there, right? If you go so far in the sincerity thing that you forget about the critique thing, where do you end up? Well, you end up in New Age land. And again, we're back to everybody just read Power of Now. Everybody wake up. There is one pure, real path, and we're this close, and you start shaking other people. Come on, be in the now. Come on, relax. Be like the completely egoless me. I don't have an ego. Why do you have one? So we don't want to end up there, but we want that spiritual quality. It is true that if we are in higher states, higher subjective states, if we do see that heaven, in a sense, is real, if we can bring one another to those places, or at least suggest them, if we're not so hysterical about it, right? If we're patient, actually, there it is, patience, right? If we're patient about it, we're patient about creating that deep transformational change, that deep spiritual bliss, that religious experience where you know that always already everything is all right. That there isn't actually this darkness or this crisis, etc. It's just confusion and it's going to go over. It's going to be tremendous and a worse roller coaster ride than you can imagine. But there is a place of hope. But knowing that we can't shove it down anybody's throats, no more our own throats, right? We can't shove hope down our own throats. So even if we would have plastered here, like one of those, do you know Alex Gray, this painter? So he makes psychedelic art, and you see, sort of see colorful tunnels of like fractals and rainbow color spirals that just go in all directions. This sort of really, 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 really high states that you can get in under strong spiritual experiences or under psychedelic seances and stuff like that. What's wrong with that? Well, it's that most people, for the most part, don't feel it. So it doesn't actually become super inspiring. It becomes kitsch, and it becomes so it will repel a lot of people. It becomes a little bit hysterical, like we're shaking each other for it, and it becomes insincere because you can't live up to it. So the new sincerity is the sincerity that is also ironic, You go, we went through the postmodern phase. We all did watch The Simpsons. We did our homework. We watched South Park. We might even have read some Foucault. We railed against power structures. And at the end of that, we found out what was true all along. Wait a minute, I'm the creator. You are. And there's a sense of responsibility and freedom in that. You can't be the rebel anymore. So, and this is a very nice Nietzsche quote. So Nietzsche becomes Zarathustra, right? And Zarathustra comes down the mountain and he tries to convey his message, right? And says, people aren't listening. And he realizes, I don't want followers. I don't want herds or believers. I want co-creators. Co-creators the creator seeketh. Those who seek to write new, those who write new values on new tablets. So, in that Nietzschean sense, I guess I'm looking also here for co-creators who share in this metamodern sensibility. You don't have to believe in the same models or ideas or theories that I do. That's just my job. But what I do when I don't, outside of my job, is I'm part of this sensibility that, okay, there is something that we can create together. Critique be damned. And my suggestion for that is the listening society. We should actually politically, as the creative class, you become aware that not anybody in any position in society could sociologically viably become a carrier of metamodernism as a movement, as a sensibility, as an art, as an aesthetic, as a political presence in the world. But the creative class can. And the creative class, maybe this is what you wanted to ask next. Yeah. That's another good thing with metamodernism and high states. You start being able to read minds. No, I'm just kidding. So one thing is, if we describe, everybody has their idea about who's the hero and so forth, right? And it can be activists, or it can be strong leaders, or it can be other ideas, right? Or it can be the meek who inherit the earth, or those who were trodden on before, and or who were unprivileged, and for that reason have more universal perspective. This is just my suggestion, but I think when it comes to this story, this little part of human history with the metamodernism becoming a sensibility present in the world, I think the creative class, and particularly what I call the triple H population, has a certain role to play. So you will notice, I think, also among the people here that I think it overlaps. So you have the first of the H's, like the letter H. You can imagine this is a Venn diagram. It's like one H here, and it says hipsters. So you have all the artsy people, all the people who are good at just feeling the vibes of culture of this day and age, and playing with those symbols. I guess I just would place myself in that category, right? I read books, I'm an intellectual, but I do follow a certain pattern. For instance, a couple of my books were out there on the table, and on the table are also lots of other books that I've been reading. And it's like, I thought I was a unique person. No, I'm not. I'm just part of a structure, and I sort of inhabit that structure. And hipsters who are also metamodernists tend to think in similar manners, right? So they tend to have this similar little house deities that they worship, or readers and so forth. And then the other part would be hippies. Because, I mean, the hippies didn't just roll over and die, right? I said a few nasty things about them today, but it is true that, hey, that depth of the gaze that people have in yoga parlors, Why do they have that, right? There's a certain depth, a certain seriousness about a certain attunement to the subtleties of reality that takes a lot of work, right? A lot of work with the body and the mind. And that's real expertise. And there's just no way we will transform society and heal all the wounds that we need to heal without richly embedding and embodying that expertise in a metamodern movement. And the third one would be hackers. I currently have, just for another couple of months, I suppose, currently have my day job from Silicon Valley, because I keep, and I worked at an IT company before as in-house philosopher, because again and again, I didn't know this when we wrote the books initially, that we did put this thing in about the hackers, but there really is something, right, to among so many people working with blockchain and holochain and all of these different things that, yeah, use symbols in another manner. So you have a triple age population. So if you take people who are only hippies, they're not math modern. They're usually postmodern. Or if you take people who are only hipsters, also not. Take people on the copy left, hackers. But if you put those two things together, two or more of these things together, the hipsters, if you're a hipster and a hippie, chances are you begin to have this more metamodern sensibility, because the hippie part will allow you the hope, right? Hacker hipster, hacker hipper hipsty. So we're getting there, right? So there is some sort of social category or class that needs to awaken. And I think in Western societies, but also places like Taiwan, and I suppose places in Africa and so forth as well, but the picture gets a little bit more complex.
And I hijacked the stage because I'm wondering now, 5 minutes, You have some final words now.
Okay, so I will use my last four minutes to give you a special background, like insider knowledge. There's a fourth age. In the book, we have the triple age model. So hackers, hippies, and hipsters. But there's actually a fourth age, the hermetics. And I was once part of organizing a festival as well in Kiev, in Ukraine. It's called the Metamodern Arts Festival. And I noticed all the time there was some sort of... the people who I thought were in the same category, hipsters, they were like in this huge fight. No, we should have aesthetics that look more like these. Or there were people who wanted, like, everything should be based on esoteric symbols, and everything should be on, based on these signs or transformations or alchemy. But they were really metamodernists. They really had this sensibility. So actually, I figured together with some friends that there must be a fourth age, and we had failed to make the distinction. That the fourth age is hermetic, so hermetic goes back to, not hermeneutic, as in a thing in the social sciences and the humanities, but hermetics as in the Hermes Trismegistus cult from the Renaissance in northern Italy. And the Hermes Trismegistus cult was full of people who saw, in that time, the Renaissance was coming out of Middle Ages, and people were sensing that modern society was possible. But the closest thing they could find, or this is my way of theorizing it anyway, the closest thing they could find in their time was ancient Greece. So they became obsessed with ancient Greece, and I thought there's actually one source or core of wisdom from which all of this flows. And they thought alchemical knowledge, how to turn lead into gold. And they thought Socrates and perhaps even the Bible, other things, came from one source, sort of, right? And in my mind, I think they were intuitively seeing, they were using symbols and trying to see the occult pattern in symbols, the hidden patterns in symbols, to stretch their minds into intuition and see what comes ahead, right? And that's sort of the fourth age. You have these mystics, and they usually like stuff like secret societies, guilds, networks, and stuff like that, right? So these four together, I think, need to find each other, make interconnections, understand each other's worlds to the best of our ability, and it's one way or another, find ways to manifest in the world. It doesn't have to be through political parties. I would be hopeful about that happening in places like Graz. But it can be through festivals to begin with, starting in the arts. I guess we're going to be in for a lot of fun surprises together with a lot of bad surprises in the coming years. And the fun surprises, I think, we can look for in these directions. And actually look for them in one another.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniel.
Thank you.
And thank you to the audience.